Numerical acoustics can be developed in the form of finite elements or boundary elements, and then there are several types of boundary element. But historically, the first acoustic element was a finite element, and we're going to study that in this lecture. It's pretty straightforward material. It's fairly accessible to structural mechanics people, such as myself, although I have to say I've had a little background in aeroelasticity as well. But the fluid mechanics here fits very well into the schemes that structural mechanics people are used to in creating finite elements. So it's a very straightforward technology. We're going to use a triangular two-dimensional finite element for an and then we're going to show a line element. We're going to show the convergence of such a line element as you get more and more of them in order to reproduce the normal modes in a finite length duct. The dominant theory that's used is Glerkin's method. We will use the velocity potential as the fluid concept. Glerkin's method is more generally one of the weighted residual methods. We'll hit the triangular element pretty hard, do a numerical example with a line element, and then go into our problem session. We're going to use the velocity potential as the fluid mechanics tool for developing our element. First, we'll summarize the equations of motion for such a fluid flow. The continuity equation, sometimes called conservation of mass, is a scalar equation. I'll use this little symbol on the right to show that you're worried about conservation of flow going out of the element and relating that to the time rate of change of density of that control volume there. In momentum, you have a vector equation in 3D involving basically accelerations and pressure gradients. We will use the linearized law for adiabatic change. Generally speaking, you have the relation for a pressure and a density perturbation where you can see that C squared then would be dP d rho, and we've talked about that earlier. And then for the adiabatic law, that would be related to the square root of gamma RT. So these two are actually coupled rather closely together, and then the adiabatic rule assumed. These fundamental equations are now manipulated to give the wave equation expressed in a velocity potential form, and then we'll convert that further into the Helmholtz equation in terms of the velocity potential. First of all, we look at the momentum equation and take the curl of that, and that means del cross into that vector quantity and setting that to be zero. Since you have a repeated del cross del here in the right-hand term, that's going to vanish because the curl of two vectors that are identical is zero. And here you have then this cross product of the velocity perturbation. If we interchange, as I've done here, the spatial and the time derivatives, and then neglect the ambient density, we'll get this expression, which says that the time rate of change of this quantity is zero. That means the quantity underlined here, which is called vorticity, won't change in time, and it's a constant. We will set that constant to be zero, perhaps seemingly arbitrarily, but really not, because our reference state is going to be for quiescent fluid. If we were to have some kind of initial fluid field, then this might not be true, but in our case it's strictly true. And when you have such an expression, you then can infer, and the logic is perhaps a little bit inverse here, that if the curl of a vector field is zero, then the vector field itself can be expressed as the as a gradient of a scalar field, and I'll define that in the next figure. I'll write out the velocity perturbation as a gradient of a field variable phi, shown here. And expanding that gradient, it's in our case the spatial derivatives with respect to x, y, and z, acting on this function of space. And this then will satisfy zero vorticity identically, because taking the curl of this will lead to identically zero. Now I wanted to show a little more here, and I'm skipping to a one-dimensional version of the discussion just to make it a little bit easier. For instance, suppose we take the momentum equation shown here and with an oblique force field to show that the fluid field is moving basically in a three-dimensional way, and I write out the momentum equation, but then I convert that to the simpler form for field motion described only in the x direction. Then my gradient term becomes only a partial on x. I do the interchange of space and time derivative again. And then I'm able to bring out the del operating on the pressure field here, the perturbed pressure field. You now have that there's a spatial derivative which is zero. Now we've gotten a partial differential equation in terms of the spatial variable x and then time. When you show that the derivative on space is zero, that means if you do an integration along the spatial direction, you'll find that the resulting parenthetical quantity has to be only a function of time, sort of an integration constant, but really a function of time. And this, here's what was the parenthetical quantity in here. And we're going to take this, quote, integration constant to be zero, because we don't care to have a perturbation quantity in here that's varying uniformly in space. I guess that's somewhat arbitrary, but we'll just do that and then solve for the pressure perturbation as a function of the time derivative of the velocity potential. Now that's universal, it turns out, even in three dimensions. So we'll be able to use that result, and it's easier to derive in this fashion. Now we return to the three-dimensional continuity equation, and we can use this result in a second. First, we replace the density variation using the adiabatic argument by a pressure variation and the speed of sound. And secondly, we can take the pressure variation here and put it in terms of the velocity potential, as we have just done above. At this level up here, actually, that goes is going to go into there, and then to give us what we have down here. Instead of this perturbation of velocity, we'll use the gradient of the potential field. Coming down to the next step, we'll combine those two delta operators into the del squared, or the Laplacian. We'll cancel the density, the ambient density, and now you're left with an equation involving two time derivatives on the velocity potential and two space derivatives, or what really in three dimensions, a second derivative in the form of Laplacian, to be zero. That's already in the form of a wave equation. And so just by rearranging terms, we get the wave equation in the potential form shown here, involving the speed of sound and second derivatives on phi. Boundary conditions are usually either put on pressure or velocity perturbations, and the pressure one immediately converts into a time derivative on phi, and the velocity immediately converts into a space derivative on phi. If we now assume harmonic wave motion, And we usually do this because we usually work in the frequency domain in our actual problem solving. Then we'll factor that e to the I omega t out as a product, and we will convert the wave equation into Helmholtz equation. What was once a minus and a second derivative on time up here will now become plus, and then you're going to have a omega over c quantity squared, which is the wave number squared. This time we get the positive sign, and here's the time derivative involved over here coming out now as a minus I omega term, and here's a space derivative. So this pressure relation here is useful, can be converted trivially into the wave number relation shown here. So this basically gives us our field equation and some useful boundary conditions. Now that we have the field equation and some suggested boundary conditions, we can try to develop the relevant equations on a closed domain that we would call a finite element. And one way to do this is a weighted residual method, namely that you try to minimize the error in your approximation over the domain of the problem. So if we were to integrate, say, over the volume of some proposed region, which for us will be a finite element, we would take the Helmholtz equation here and then use a weight W and then integrate over the volume in question. By setting that to zero, you've then implied that you've done the best job you can in an average way to remove the error in whatever approximate values you choose for the phi, which is our answer. Well, one way to handle that equation is to use Green's first identity and work on this second derivative term up above and try to turn that into first derivative terms. This is often done in these weighted residual approaches because it's a smoothing process, it turns out, to work with lower derivatives. So when you do this, you get a boundary term which involves the first derivative, namely in the normal direction to the surface, times the weight over here. And the product that you have, you see, is del squared phi times W d volume. And the W is unchanged, but you go one integral up on the phi variable and get this normal derivative. And then the volume integral with a minus sign on it has the first derivative of both of the functions involved. The other term carries straight away down below without any modification. We'll now look at the surface terms involved in that relation. One area of the surface called S sub P is where the pressure is specified and given a functional value, say phi tilde. The other area, S sub V, is where velocity is specified and given some functional values, say gamma. So this gamma is basically an outflow of velocity over that surface. Now, we're going to not worry about the error caused by the surface effects on this surface S sub P. One way to explain that is to say that we'll pick weight functions that are zero on that surface. The argument is actually tougher than that. It's actually easier to see in some other related developments using virtual work or potential energy, but it's known that this term needs to be removed. And so therefore, on the after some reduction in terms here, on the right side there would have been two integrals, one on SU, the other one on S sub P, but we're going to neglect this one by saying the weight function is zero over that surface. And we're left then with this slightly rewritten equation here. I'll just kind of draw a great big box. Now the right-hand side actually becomes like a forcing function on the rest of the problem, where this is a flow-induced type of force on this, the response of this system. Now let's develop some specific finite elements. The heart of this approach is to use shape functions. And these are interpolating polynomials that are chosen to give unit values at a home node and then zero values at other nodes. We need to consider a series solution for the field variable phi here, and this is after you've factored out the time dependence, in which these are the shape functions n sub j, and then there are nodal values phi sub j, which initially would have been functions of time, now are considered to be constants. And these measure the magnitude of phi then in a harmonic oscillating situation. The elements themselves could be a tetrahedra, a hexa element, a wedge element here, or a so-called pentahedra. The shape functions that are used can fall into several families. There are Lagrange polynomials and there are serendipity functions, which we're interested in here. The serendipity functions are those that are in a product form, and they're most easily generated when one has mapped the physical element onto a double unit square, say here, or a double unit cube in three dimensions. The physical element might be oblique, but the parent element is a square or a cube. And because these node points are regularly spaced, it's pretty easy to guess what a set of shape functions should be. For instance, if you want a shape function that has a unit value here and zero values at these other three points, you can just take the equations for lines that pass through these two and these two and take the product of those, and you'll end up with a quadratic surface that will have the required properties. This will be done in the C1, C2 plane, and so your shape functions are written initially as functions of C1 and C2, and then with the nodal values in that C plane. Let's start by looking at the first shape function. This one should have a unit value at the first node down here with coordinates of -1, -1. And you can see that this product will do the job by substituting C1 to be -1 and getting a value of 2 for this parenthetical term. And C2 is -1, gives a value of 2 as well. Divided by 4, you've got 2 times 2 divided by 4. Lo and behold, that works. And then the other shape functions in turn can be developed. In each case, these are actually equations of straight lines, and in the sense that there would be a third coordinate, even if you wish, call it C3 equals a function of C1 and C2. And then rather than setting this quantity to be 0, which would give you the locus of the line in question, you just leave it not 0 and then treat it as a surface. So that's how you can develop this product form. We're going to use the same functions for our weighting functions as we used for our trial functions. And often that's referred to as Galerkin's method. So that these shape functions n sub I appear as weights in several places in this same equation. And you have then the other terms, which were the first derivative terms, and here the boundary terms. If we carry out an expansion of the velocity function here, a velocity potential, in terms of unknown coefficients phi j times the shape functions n j, then we get in each case this series that shows up. Now, when you have derivatives which are occurring here, then you'll bring those derivatives inside the summation, and in each case, depending on the coordinate in question, you'll really end up taking derivatives of shape functions with respect to these coordinates. And these are indeed known quantities, whereas the nodal value now becomes the unknown quantity. It's now necessary to rearrange terms. And what's commonly done is to take the integral into the summation by passing it through the summation sign. Now these processes we've discussed involve derivatives, integrals, and summations. And these are finite sums, these are proper integrals, and we're assuming that the functions are smooth so that the derivatives are well behaved. And that's what allows us to interchange those operations. That comes out of advanced calculus. So after having regrouped terms and bringing the integral inside, you start noticing some packages here, such as this del ni, del nj, and that will be given a term, kij, shown below here. That becomes a kind of an acoustic stiffness in analogy with the structural stiffness. Then here's a term that shows up with an ni, ni, the displacement field, or in originally a velocity field squared. This was related to a kinetic energy initially, and when you have the k in it, you'll get something closer to that. The integral itself might be thought of as a mass term, and it's given the coefficient m with subscript ij. And then on the right-hand side is a volume flow per unit time, and now this has been integrated in a way that gives you a nodal volume flow, positive out of the node. There's no direction implied in terms of east, west, north, south. This is a scalar type of load that it's a flow coming out of the node, so there isn't any particular direction implied. And that would be similar to current in a node in an electrical circuit, whether into or out of the particular node. So up to this point, these have been general relations, and we now have the general formulas for finite elements. Now let's develop an acoustic triangular element. This will be kind of fun, and it will be the equivalent of a Turner triangle, that is a constant strain stress element. It's going to be two-dimensional. It's going to have thickness h, so that when we get to volume integration, we'll have to integrate through the thickness as well. And we're going to try to find the so-called pressure energy and the kinetic energy terms. Now, these are basically the stiffness and the mass terms for this element. And then let's find the equivalent nodal acoustic flux due to the velocity field capital gamma on the bottom surface, and that's a mass flow out of the element. So that should be a positive type of equivalent nodal flux. First, we'll develop the shape functions for this particular triangle, and they're written here. The N2 and N3 versions are probably the easiest to tell because they are just proportionately these planes that that pass through the home node, and N3 in particular is the one that's illustrated over here. Then we have to evaluate the pressure energy term here, which is the first derivative of the shape function shown below, turning that into specific shape functions yields these terms. What was a constant strain element in structures now becomes a constant velocity element in acoustics. I'll just evaluate those terms for the case of K11, and you get this resulting pressure term, pressure energy term, or stiffness. Here's K12, K13. The remaining three stiffness terms are shown in this next figure. One of them is zero, which is interesting. But the others all have finite symbolic values. Let's assemble all of those terms into a pressure matrix. That's shown here. The element thickness is uniformly found in each of the terms. Then the acoustic mass is a real terror, and I'll do that without much comment. We'll take a typical term shown here, and you have to integrate this over the triangular region, which is not trivial this time because you don't have derivatives to turn these into constants, so you're actually integrating polynomials over a triangular region. In any event, here's a portion of the calculation which is finished on the next page, and here's the final value, and coming out with this answer. Then I collect results and put it into this mass matrix, or kinetic energy matrix. And an interesting thing is that the total mass terms, when added up, add up to the triangle volume. So this is a volumetric type of a matrix. And since it's one-dimensional in the structural sense that a pressure goes up or down, it's a scalar, it's not a vector, therefore the sum total of terms add up to just one times the mass of the triangular volume. Lastly, we'll do the equivalent nodal fluxes due to that flux capital gamma on the bottom. And that's the inner product shown here of the specified flow times the shape function evaluated on that edge. By putting in the shape function and the proper evaluation here, turning the crank, you get this quantity, gamma HB over 2. This would be the flux acting on node number 1, positive outward, and we do get a positive quantity, which we had expected. The other two equivalent nodal fluxes are found in the same way. And here gamma 2, with the constant outward flow times the shape function N2 evaluated on that bottom edge. Turning the crank, you get another gamma BH over 2, which is this quantity shown here. So we've gotten these two now. When you do the third one, however, you find that by evaluating N3 along the cut edge at the bottom is identically 0, shown here. And so this time we get no equivalent nodal flux up at this top node due to an imposed outflow volume on the bottom edge. That should ring familiar to those people who understand the constant strain triangle in structural mechanics. And then here is the total equivalent nodal flux vector, in which you get half of the outflow occurring at each of the two nodes. Now let's look at a numerical example and see how well our finite element idea performs. Here's a rather large element, pretty much room size, 10 meters on a side, which would be in English measure about 33 feet by 33 feet, but in a triangular shape, so there wouldn't be many rooms really shaped like this. The question is to find the normal modes and frequencies of this particular shaped element. I'll use rather standard values for density and speed of sound. The speed of sound is a little cooler than some people take as a and therefore a little slower than some typical values. I've used a numerical value out of Pierce's book that he used in some examples. So these are not exactly standard temperature and pressure at sea level. These are just arbitrary values chosen. And using our stiffness matrix for acoustics, we have this matrix, and then putting in the dimensions in the meter kilogram second system, we have this matrix on the right. In acoustics, you can check the possibility of a constant pressure mode, which corresponds to a rigid body mode in structural mechanics, by looking at the determinant of that acoustic pressure matrix or stiffness matrix. When we do that, we find that the determinant of the matrix is zero. That means it's singular, and that there do exist zero eigenvalues to this dynamic problem that we pose below. In this case, there will be one such zero frequency corresponding to an elevation and pressure uniformly over the element. When we do pose the dynamic equations of motion here with both this stiffness and inertia term, we get this form. It's natural to bring out an eigenvalue lambda defined here in terms of the wave number. And from this, we're hoping now to solve in a formal way this eigenvalue problem. It's in the standard form, it turns out, when we choose to not allow volume flow into any of the three nodes. And that corresponds to an element that has rigid walls and doesn't permit flow in or out of the boundaries. Therefore, none of the three equivalent nodal volume fluxes will have any value. They'll all be zero. So that leaves us with the unknowns shown here of the three nodal velocity potential terms. Our goal is to find the eigenvalues of this general eigenvalue problem, and the eigenvalues themselves will be related to the frequency of vibration of that mass of air contained within the triangular element. Then the modes, or the mode shapes, are going to be the pressure fields basically throughout that same element and give us some idea of how the fluid is packing against one wall when it's under compression or moving away from the wall when it's in a rarefaction. And we'll see that in a minute. Here is the equation of motion again in a form with the eigenvalue shown. You combine the terms and you have this form of the equation, something like a dynamical matrix here on an eigenvector, and basically you're mapping the eigenvector into zero, the zero vector. The condition that you can do this is that the equation here is singular, the set of equations is singular, and you check that by the determinant of the total dynamical matrix here on the left. When you set that to be zero, there's a common factor of lambda outside, which shows that there's one zero frequency involved. That's that constant pressure mode. But then, using the quadratic formula, you find two other frequencies given here. They come out in simple ratios 1 and 3, and then we can interpret that in terms of frequencies in the next figure. We recover the frequencies of vibration from that eigenvalue, and that's done here, then putting the frequencies closer and closer to a final numerical form. We express it in terms of the lambda, and then we get this form. Finally, we substitute the actual eigenvalues of the problem that we found, the 0, the 1, and the 3, and then we recover, and then putting in the proper other constants here. We put in lambda 1 is 0, call it the lowest, which is a 0 frequency, and then you get 0 here. Lambda 2 had a unit value, which is put in on the right side here, and that gives you 18 hertz. Lambda 3, which was a 3 value, gives you roughly 32 hertz. So those are the frequencies of that entrained air inside that closed triangular box. So we now have the frequencies, roughly 0, 18, and 32 hertz. Now, to to what kind of a velocity and pressure distribution do those correspond? Well, we find the eigenvectors to do that. And by the way, the method that we just used for a single element is called the determinant method for finding the eigenvalues. That's actually pretty old-fashioned nowadays. That's not used so much. It's only valid for small problems. When you use the determinant method to find eigenvalues, then you can substitute back in and find the eigenvector terms by elimination, by a Gauss elimination sort of a procedure. Here I write out the equations for the lambda zero case shown here, and you can solve these simultaneously by taking equations 2 and 3 and working with them, and you'll get that phi 2 is the same as phi 1, and then finally phi 3 is the same as phi 1. That gives you then a vector, an eigenvector, the first one by this subscript outside the curly braces, an eigenvector that has the same value in each component. We normalize that arbitrarily to have a unit value shown here, and I show it as this elevated surface where phi is above the xy plane and shows these phi values. Now, the closest thing we could easily approximate that to is a pressure field. So, and there's some complex relation there, but it's good just to think of it as pressure. And you see that what you have then is equivalent of a small pressure induced into that chamber, and which raises uniformly the pressure in the entire chamber. And it's a degenerate vibration at zero frequency. For the second mode, we'll do something similar by putting back the eigenvalue lambda equal to unity and putting it into the acoustic pressure matrix or stiffness matrix, looking for a zero determinant of that matrix. And what we get is this form here where phi 2 and phi 3 are related, in fact, in an inverse way with a minus sign. The second equation can be worked on to give phi 1 is 0, and that means that you have a pressure field normalized here with 0 in the first term and unity in the second, minus unity in the third, and it's kind of a teeter-totter shape shown here for the pressure field. Now, what that really means is that you've got a wave traveling along this long dimension of the element along the hypotenuse. It's actually angled in this view here. It's a little hard to see. But then the air will, on one half of the cycle, compress in this side, and then on the next half will compress on the far side. Since velocities go like derivatives of this function, you do have a bit of a paradox where there's a mismatch in velocity at this boundary. And that's something that mismatch is something that we've hoped to minimize with the Glerken method. That error is a part of the approximate nature of this particular body. You'd wonder how can the fluid pass through the wall if it has a velocity there, but if you look into the theory, you find that that's not an exact boundary condition in this problem. Nevertheless, that frequency then of roughly 18 hertz is about what the wave speed is for a wave basically traveling the long dimension of the element and then rebounding, and ultimately setting up a standing wave because of its sister wave going in the opposite direction. And then these are the pressure magnitudes. Let's now look at the third mode and find the pressures at the nodes in that case. There we have lambda of 3. We put that into this dynamical matrix, finding this reduced matrix numerically. Then the question is, can you find phi 1, phi 2, phi 3? Now, the determinant of this is going to be 0 if you check it out. And that was a condition by which we originally found the lambda to be 3. This time we do have to solve simultaneously with equations 2 and 1 being subtracted, and this time you get that phi 3 and phi 2 are the same. The equation 1 is combined with equation 3 to get this value that phi 2 is half of phi 1. And adding those results, we get the third eigenvector shown below here. That doesn't tell you very much. You need the figure shown over here to see what it is. Notice that this time we have a unit height on the origin there where the one corner of the element is, and then along the hypotenuse you only have the minus 0.5 terms. What that does is establish a nodal line in the Chladni sense, a third of the way across here, and I have to project that into the xy plane and find the intersection. And that means that on this particular half of the cycle shown, you've got the fluid rushing to the left and compressing against the origin here. And then on the opposite half of the cycle, the fluid would return to the other direction, causing actually a focusing effect at the point over here and giving higher pressures by a factor of 2 than when it rushes to the other side and rebounds. So it's an interesting focusing idea. This time we're finding what we're basically getting in a top view is the frequencies in a closed container where the fluid is rushing back and forth perpendicular to the longest dimension, which is the hypotenuse. And so this would naturally be a higher frequency because it has the shortest wavelength that you might propose for fluid to move in that chamber. It's instructive now to do a sanity check on this set of results for frequencies. I think we've already got a sanity check on the mode shape because it seems to make sense, but we'll talk about those as well. Certainly starting with the constant pressure mode, that's a physically realizable sort of situation. One way you could idealize that situation would be if there was a small puff of air put into the chamber and then the opening was sealed. That would uniformly raise the pressure in the chamber and then it would stay there. Since we have fixed boundaries here that are reflective sealed boundaries. Now, of course, this takes a small perturbation to imagine that, and that's always done in the sense of an eigenvalue problem that you have to assume that there's some event that would cause the eigenvector to oscillate. But once it started, it maintains itself. In this case, the constant pressure field maintains itself. And I like to think of it as an oscillation with zero frequency. I'll plot the pressure field in the second mode in the next figure. It's shown as the shaded surface here. If you imagine that in the opposite phase where the pressure is reverse sign, then there would be a surface that would pass in this manner. And then there would be a Chladni nodal line along this direction from the origin out to the middle of the hypotenuse, and that would be a line on which pressures would stay zero. Currently, with the phasing shown at time zero, the red surface given here, there would be a positive pressure along the near face and a negative pressure on the far face. With this pressure field, it would tend to make the velocity then move particles away from the near wall in this direction. Let's concentrate on the pressure field on that cut edge of the hypotenuse, and I'll do that in the figure here on the left. The opposite phasing in time would give the dashed line, which would be the pressure reversal. One way to look at this would be to say that although we're interested in the pressures within this closed chamber, which is our triangular element, That actually, by mere images, we could extend that pressure field outside the walls into neighboring mirror image elements. When we think along those lines, we realize that what we're trying to do is predict a pressure field that's actually a sine wave. I probably won't draw it very well here. And that what we're really trying to get is a zero slope to that pressure field at the wall. If I plot below then the velocity, which would be the derivative along the hypotenuse direction, I would get the square wave shown below. And this brings up the paradox then that you have the jump in velocity at the wall. So there's a discontinuity in the velocity boundary condition. That's okay, however. To argue that, you almost have to go into some energy concepts and show that there's no energy lost by that jump. But we can take that on faith. And it's also found in the Turner constant strain triangle in structural mechanics, where you get a jump across the inter-element lines in strain and ultimately in stress. I'd like to make a side argument now about how standing waves are in fact created by two traveling waves in opposite direction with the same speed. So we'll do a mental experiment shown in the three figures below. First, at time zero, let's imagine that there's a red wave shown here which will travel to the right with speed c, the speed of sound. There's also a blue wave that will travel to the left at that same speed. They're meant to be coincident, but I've slightly offset them so you can see the different colors. We're plotting the field variable here, which is the pressure field. The characteristic length that we're interested in corresponds to L here, the distance between our two rigid walls, say in our triangular finite element. At a time later, delta T later, which we'll take to be L over C, that would be just sufficient time for the point, say, on the red wave at its peak to move over one characteristic distance, which I've shown in the second figure here. Likewise, the blue wave will move one characteristic distance L to the left. At this point, the two traveling waves reinforce each other again, but with opposite polarity from the top figure. You can also see that this will constitute a half period in time, because if we do this experiment again and look at 2 delta T, you will see then that the waves reinforce with their original polarity. And so that constitutes a return to the original position and what we mean by a full cycle of motion. We can then construct what we call a frequency here, which would be 1 over that period. And I can just sketch it here right on the drawing, that frequency would equal then 1 over the period. Well, the period we're talking about now is 2L over C, so it would be C over 2L. That's not really obvious, and I think you have to sit and think about this a bit. And we'll carry forward, though, this concept of how you get a standing wave frequency from a traveling wave speed of sound and characteristic distance. I'll write down that formula again for the frequency here. And the thing to remember is that